Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Not One Inch, America, Russia, and the Making of Post-Cold War Stalemate by Emmy Sarotte, narrated by Teri Schnaubelt. Ennus tekai natois palai tekmairitai. A man of sense judges the new events by the past. Sophocles, Oedipus Rex, 916. Note on names and places. This book's reliance on evidence in languages other than English creates challenges in spelling proper nouns in the main text. In the interest of producing a clearly written English language account, I have adopted anglicized versions of frequently cited place names, such as Pristina for Pristine or Pristina, and Visegrad for Visegrad. I also refer to East Germany and West Germany, although those exact names are relatively infrequent in the original German language sources from the Cold War. Those sources generally refer to the eastern half of the divided country by its formal name, the German Democratic Republic, or GDR, and to the western half as the Federal Republic of Germany, or FRG. I also use East Berlin for the capital of East Germany, although the ruling regime generally called its half of the divided city Berlin. A further complication arises from the fact that, after unification on October 3, 1990, newly reunited Germany kept the former West German name, so references to the FRG after that date describe the united country. With regard to individuals, I have tried to provide names in the original spelling where feasible, that is, if there are no common English equivalents and the original is not in a different alphabet. Contests over borders create further complications. After Ukraine's December 1, 1991 vote to break away from the Soviet Union, this book switches the spelling of the capital city from Kiev to the version preferred by the newly independent state, Kiev. Another contested issue was the status of the three Baltic countries during the Soviet era. Neither they nor the United States, among other countries, recognized their incorporation into the USSR. Moscow dominated the Baltics, nonetheless, and they were commonly shown as part of the Soviet Union on maps. Bearing the non-recognition in mind, this book follows the convention of showing the Baltics as part of the USSR after their incorporation. Introduction. Foreclosing options. It is the hallmark of any deep truth that its negation is also a deep truth. Max Delbruck. Not One Inch. The fight over Europe's future beyond the Cold War entered its decisive phase with these words, spoken in February 1990 by the American Secretary of State James Baker to the leader of the Soviet Union, Mikhail Gorbachev. The Berlin Wall's collapse on November 9, 1989, had by then gravely weakened Moscow's grip on Central Europe. But thanks to the Soviet victory over the Nazis in World War II, decades later, Moscow still had hundreds of thousands of troops in East Germany and the legal rights to keep them there. To convince Gorbachev to relinquish this military and legal might, Baker uttered the words as a hypothetical bargain. What if you let your part of Germany go, and we agree that NATO will not shift one inch eastward from its present position? A controversy erupted over this exchange almost immediately, at first behind closed doors and then publicly. But more important was the decade to follow when these three words took on far-reaching new meanings. Gorbachev did let his part of Germany go, but along the way, Washington rethought its options, not least after the Soviet Union's collapse in December 1991. The United States realized it could not only win big, but win bigger. Not one inch of territory need be off limits to NATO. Washington could lead the alliance in opening a path for large numbers of eager new members to join. In the 1990s, it did just that, resulting by March 12, 1999, in enlargement across Central and Eastern Europe and to the Polish-Russian border. But on December 31st of that year, Vladimir Putin rose to the top in Moscow. As NATO kept expanding, he ultimately decided to use violence in an effort to ensure that not one inch more of territory would join. The game of moving by inches resulted in a stalemate. Between the fall of the wall and the rise of Putin, animosity between Moscow and Washington over NATO's future became central to the making of a post-Cold War political order that looked much like its Cold War predecessor, and to the unmaking of hopes for cooperation from Vancouver to Vladivostok. To show how and why, this book examines the conflict between Russia and America against the backdrop of the sprawling, unpredictable landscape of the 1990s. That decade witnessed the astonishing overnight collapse of an empire, yielding a host of new Eurasian states, produced visionary leaders, some rising from prisons to presidencies, earning Nobel Prizes and global admiration, and redefined the realm of the possible for democratization, disarmament, market economies, and the tenets of liberal international order. But it also opened the door to new expressions of authoritarianism, de-democratization, and ethnic cleansing. Telling the unruly history of the 90s as a narrative is hard but necessary. Without a story to follow, the odds of getting from the beginning to the end of the list of actors, concepts, and locales approaches zero. This book uses the fight over NATO expansion as its through line. It tells the story not of the alliance itself, but of the strategic choices that American and Russian leaders made during their decade-long conflict over the start of its enlargement to Central and Eastern Europe, and of the cumulative weight of those choices on today's world. The book begins with a focus on the 1989 contest over the future of divided Germany, which, for Washington, swiftly turned into a struggle to preserve the Atlantic Alliance. Then, widening its field of view, the book examines how American success produced opportunities for the courageous leaders of new European democracies, but also challenges for the West's relationship with former Soviet republics, most notably for Western efforts to cure, as one American defense secretary memorably put it, their nuclear hangover. Widening still more, the book shows how the way expansion was implemented brought a loss of options for 21st-century transatlantic relations. Throughout, the book asks how and why U.S. Presidents George H.W. Bush and Bill Clinton, together with their European contemporaries Tony Blair, Jacques Chirac, Václav Havel, Helmut Kohl, John Major, François Mitterrand, Gerhard Schroeder, Margaret Thatcher, and Lech Walesa, plus Baltic leaders and NATO Secretaries General Manfred Werner and Javier Solana, launched the enlargement that eventually took the alliance to 30 nations. This accomplishment represented a major success for American strategists. It saved many, though not all, of the new post-Cold War democracies from life in a security gray zone between East and West. With Washington's help, over 100 million Central and Eastern Europeans enjoyed well-deserved success in their efforts to become NATO allies. And as it enlarged, the alliance helped to quell bloody conflicts in the Balkans. Today, NATO stretches from North America, Iceland, and Greenland to the United Kingdom, Europe, and the Baltics, covering nearly a billion people. Its members all possess the so-called Article 5 guarantee, a promise rooted in the alliance's founding treaty. An armed attack against one or more of them shall be considered an attack against them all. Since gaining that guarantee, the new members of the alliance have indeed remained free from large-scale armed attacks, even as fighting began across some former Soviet borders. American military might and its deterrent power remain the cornerstone of the alliance's strength. Yet success came at a price. It is no small thing to guarantee the security of a billion people. In the 1990s, two American presidents were so focused on achieving the eastward extension of Article 5 that they did not sufficiently consider the consequences of how they achieved that goal. As President Bush said in response to the idea that Washington might compromise with Moscow over NATO's future, to hell with that. President Clinton was certain that Russia could be bought off. Along the way, a promising alternative mode of enlargement, in the form of a partnership that would have avoided drawing a new line across Europe, fell to hardline opposition. This tougher attitude achieved results, but it obscured options that might have sustained cooperation, decreased chances of U.S.-Russian conflict reoccurring, and served Washington's interests better in the longer term. Put differently, the expansion of NATO was a justifiable response to the challenges of the 1990s and to the entreaties of new Central and Eastern European democracies. The problem was how it happened. The fall of the wall in 1989 had briefly created the potential for a newly cooperative post-Cold War order. But a decade later, the border between NATO and non-NATO Europe remained a clearly demarcated front line. Ukraine and other post-Soviet states languished in a gray zone, nuclear competition was renewing, and early hopes for cooperation had waned. And the manner of enlargement had contributed to that outcome. Perhaps it was not surprising that the outcome would be contentious, given that, throughout the 1990s, American leaders had to struggle with the tension between two priorities. Either they could enable the region of Central and Eastern Europe writ large, including post-Soviet states such as the Baltics and Ukraine, to choose its own destiny at long last, regardless of the impact on Moscow, or they could promote cooperation with Russia's fragile new democracy, particularly in the interest of nuclear disarmament. The question for Washington was figuring out which of these goals should take precedence. The correct answer was both. As the Nobel Prize-winning scientist Max Delbruck writes, the negation of any simple, correct statement is a false statement. But it is the hallmark of any deep truth that its negation is also a deep truth. Light is a particle. Light is a wave. Translated into geopolitical terms, this insight illuminates the tension between the two compelling truths, or strategic imperatives, facing the United States after the end of the Cold War. Washington's highest priority should be the peoples formerly dominated by Moscow. Washington's highest priority should be Moscow. When the choice is between two such profoundly significant imperatives, the smart move is to avoid rushing to a decision, and the best way to do that is to avoid calling the question too soon. It is the job of those engaged in top-level statecraft to figure out the smart move and the best timing. In Washington in the early 1990s, some did. Strategists inside the Bush administration's State Department and, more significantly, inside the Clinton administration's Pentagon produced policies that gave both strategic imperatives their due and gave Washington leeway on the timing of irrevocable decisions. They implemented a strategy of incremental security partnership, open to European and post-Soviet states alike, ultimately embodied in the Partnership for Peace, PFP. Through this partnership, potential NATO members could gain experience in working with the West and acquire the full weight of the Article 5 guarantee over time. Such a widely applicable, incremental approach did not require Washington either to draw a new line through post-Cold War Europe or leave Ukraine and most other post-Soviet republics to their own devices. It might also have helped to entrench a new democratic order in Central and Eastern Europe, since subsequent events demonstrated that the prospect of incrementally gaining membership in desirable institutions, not membership itself, most effectively solidifies reforms. But having figured out the smart move, Washington called the question too soon anyway, and the American decision to do so ultimately combined with Russia's own tragic choices in fateful ways. Once President Boris Yeltsin made decisions in late 1993 and 1994 to shed the blood of his opponents in Moscow and Chechnya, and Russian voters decided to give anti-reform extremists a victory in the December 1993 parliamentary elections, The survival of a vision of partnership that included both Moscow and the peoples it once dominated became much more challenging. Rampant inflation in Russia as part of the transition to a market economy only intensified the sense of disintegrating hopes. Bloodshed in the Balkans added urgency to all questions of European security and created new frictions between Washington and Moscow over how to handle the violence. Domestic developments in the United States, most notably the stunning victory of the Republican Party in the 1994 midterm congressional elections, similarly influenced foreign policy, tilting Clinton toward a different, more confrontational strategy of alliance enlargement. Savvy members of the U.S. National Security Council and State Department seized upon these events and on Central and Eastern Europeans' urgent appeals for full Article 5 guarantees to best the Pentagon in constructing the post-Cold War geopolitical order. Military planners had played a surprisingly small role in policy formulation in the years immediately after the fall of the wall. The Pentagon under Bush complained that, while consulted, it had no real input, and were eventually relegated to the back seat again under Clinton. American advocates of more assertive expansion, emphasizing that Central and Eastern Europe had suffered too many historical wrongs and waited too long to join the West, switched the mode of NATO enlargement. Instead of incremental accession by a large number of states, they had the alliance extend the full weight of the Article 5 guarantee to a small number of states. While their motives had merit, their motive expansion accelerated the timing and drew a new line between the former Soviet bloc states that had managed to secure Article 5 and those that had not. One consequence was that American options for managing post-Cold War contingency, namely through the creation of a variety of relationships with such states, most notably with Georgia and Ukraine, became dramatically more limited just as Putin was rising within the ranks in Russia. Some commentators recognized, at the time, the cost of calling the question too soon. George Kennan, the former U.S. ambassador to Moscow, who, in the 1940s, had conceived of the American strategy of containment, argued that post-Cold War NATO expansion tipped the balance too far away from the protecting newfound cooperation with Moscow. Even Baker later recognized in his memoirs that every achievement contains within its success the seeds of a future problem. Those seeds took root in the relationship between what remain the globe's two nuclear superpowers, the United States and Russia. Despite the passing of the Cold War, these two nations still possess more than 90% of the world's nuclear warheads and the ability to kill nearly every living creature on Earth. That threat makes understanding the decay in their relationship in the 1990s an essential story of our time, because it eroded the best chance for establishing lasting cooperation between them. Cold wars are not short-lived affairs, so thaws are precious. Neither country made the best possible use of the thaw in the 90s. After unexpectedly being delivered from the threat of a nuclear confrontation with each other, they let deliverance slip. The effects of American and Russian decisions during that critical decade have been far-reaching. The window of opportunity for comprehensive strategic nuclear disarmament, the most significant opening since the dawn of the atomic age, closed relatively quickly. By the end of the 1990s, as the book will show, intelligence agencies reported on the beginnings of renewed nuclear competition. Other forms of competition emerged soon thereafter, not least in the shredding of hard-won arms control accords. Today's permissive environment of a world almost wholly lacking such accords means both sides are reassessing the roles of not just nuclear, but also conventional capabilities. In Europe in recent years, both the post-Cold War American drawdown of forces and the Russian shift of troops eastward have reversed. Increasing tensions have also raised questions about not just physical, but also economic security. As the historian Adam Tooze has shown, renewed Russian aggression reveals that the post-Cold War disavowal of the obvious connection between trade and security policy was a grievous error, one fully exposed by the resurgence of Putin's Russia. Despite having a GDP not that much larger than Spain's, once the cooperative spirit died, Russia began leveraging its military assets to upend the geopolitical balance in Western Asia and the Middle East, and its cyber capabilities to wound governments and businesses around the globe. Given the profound consequences, it is crucial to understand the root cause, why relations between Moscow and Washington deteriorated so badly after a period of so much promise. This deterioration was all the more startling because of how close Russia and the United States briefly were in the 1990s. One measure of this rapport was Yeltsin's reaction to Baker's request in 1991 for the most closely held secret of state, details of how Moscow would launch nuclear attacks. The Russian leader provided them willingly, partly to curry favor with Baker and to win American help in his power struggle with Gorbachev, but partly out of trust. Moscow and Washington began a brief but extraordinary collaboration in countering nuclear proliferation. Another measure came in 1997, when Yeltsin had his own request for Clinton. What if we were to give up having to have our finger next to the button all the time? The American president responded, "Well, if we do the right thing in the next 4 years, maybe we won't have to think as much about this problem." By the end of the 1990s, however, trust had largely vanished. Putin divulged little in his grudging conversations with Clinton and the American president's top Russia advisor, Strobe Talbot. Instead of sharing nuclear secrets, he gave the Americans his account of the grim consequences of reduced Russian power. In former Soviet regions, terrorists now played soccer with the decapitated heads of their hostages. The idea that Putin would reveal launch protocols to Clinton was laughable. What happened? To break that enormous question down into more manageable components, why did the United States decide to enlarge NATO after the Cold War? How did the American decision interact with contemporary Russian choices? And did that interaction yield the fateful decline in relations between the two countries? Were there feasible alternatives to the decisions that they made? What was the cost of expansion as it occurred? And how did it help to shape the era between the Cold War and COVID? Finally, recognizing from the Italian philosopher Benedetto Croce that all history is ultimately contemporary history, written with an eye on today's concerns, if we widen the time horizon, how can knowledge of this history guide efforts to create a better future? These questions receive detailed answers over the course of the narrative and in the conclusion, but it is worth previewing the argument here. NATO enlargement did not, by itself, cause the deterioration of U.S.-Russian relations. Major events happen for multiple reasons. History is rarely, if ever, monocausal. American and Russian choices interacted with each other cumulatively over time and with each country's domestic politics to produce the decay. Misunderstanding played a role as well. As the former U.S. ambassadors Alexander Virchbaugh and Daniel Freed have written, both the Bush and Clinton administrations were mistaken in some basic assumptions about post-Soviet Russia. Both failed to understand the extent to which the liberation of Central and Eastern Europe, when viewed from Moscow, looked more like imperial collapse. But it is hard to avoid the reality that alliance expansion added to the burdens on Russia's fragile young democracy when it was in most need of friends. As Talbot told Chirac in 1997, "The Russian side is all screwed up." The American added, "I don't say that disrespectfully, but in recognition of the way that Russians have gone through one of the greatest traumas in history, with more sudden change in their internal order, external relations, and ideology than any other country, which has not lost a major war." The result was that, as the historian Margaret Macmillan has written, after the collapse of both the Berlin Wall and the Soviet Union, the world stood at a crossroads with competing visions of how the future should unfold, not just in economic, but also in security terms. The alliance's expansion became a major factor in the subsequent competition among various visions of the future. The stories of NATO expansion and of Moscow's modern time of troubles became intertwined, while the best chance for lasting cooperation between the nuclear superpowers dwindled, unmaking the precious post-Cold War moment of optimism. I experienced some of that optimism firsthand as a young American studying abroad in West Berlin in 1989. Ever since then, I have been trying to understand the political legacy of events that I witnessed as a bystander. But how can I, or indeed anyone not directly involved in top-level political decisions, claim to know the NATO expansion story? The answer is that interactions between leaders of governments and states, and then with their own advisors, comrades, congresses, parliaments, and peoples, generate mountains of paperwork that are generally kept secret. Once the Berlin Wall collapsed, however, so too did the Warsaw Pact states' ability to keep their documents and secrets hidden. I began researching in such sources in the 1990s, most notably in the files of the East German secret police, the Stasi. I also started conducting interviews and writing the first of what eventually became a series of books and articles on the Cold War and its legacy for today, including The Collapse, The Accidental Opening of the Berlin Wall, and 1989, The Struggle to Create Post-Cold War Europe. In the opening decade of this century, I began a sustained effort to see if I could get the corresponding Western documents, most of which were still under lock and key, declassified and released. In a sense, I created my own archive based on declassifications from six countries, even as I took advantage of regular archival openings and sources that other researchers had declassified. This process took many years, partly because there were numerous locations and partly because I had to persuade many people and institutions to grant me access. If simple requests failed, appeals became necessary, adding more years to the process. My research in this evidence produced the analysis that follows. Some research breakthroughs and publications are worth noting here. In 2007, James Baker generously allowed me to access the collection of his papers that he had donated to Princeton University, including documents from crucial meetings in Moscow in 1990. In 2008, hardworking staff at the George H.W. Bush Presidential Library helped me to file many hundreds of hard copy requests, opening up new avenues not just for me, but for other researchers as well. In 2009, I was able to reverse a denial of my 2005 request to see German Foreign Ministry records after former German Foreign Minister Joschka Fischer and others were kind enough to prompt the ministry to reconsider. In 2014, NATO decided to implement its so-called Directive on the Public Disclosure of NATO Information, giving me a wedge with which to pry open alliance archives with the help of staff in Brussels. Perhaps the biggest challenge, however, was declassifying transcripts of Clinton's conversations with Yeltsin, which required 3 years of appeals after my initial request in 2015 and 2016 failed. With the help of archivists and others dedicated to transparency, however, my appeals to the William J. Clinton Presidential Library ultimately succeeded in 2018, yielding a collection so rich, including in references to Putin, that Russian presidential spokesman Dmitry Peskov protested the library's declassification of documents concerning current politicians, meaning, above all, his boss. But not everything is written down. I benefited enormously from the willingness of more than 100 participants in events to share their memories in interviews. Their names appear in the bibliography, and they have my gratitude. Given the limits of human memory, it is understandably hard to remember exact words used decades ago. I also compared those interviews to the archival evidence whenever possible. When inconsistencies arose, I stuck with the written record from the historical time period. In other words, I followed a hierarchy of evidence for this book. Sources produced as events were happening and held securely since then, what historians call primary sources, represent a higher caliber of evidence than comments made or interviews conducted years or decades later. In a further effort to provide the most accurate possible record of remarks on the controversial topic of NATO expansion, the quotations in this book come exclusively from printed or recorded matter, not from my memory of interviews or of evidence. I have further differentiated quotations into ones I found in primary sources, indicated by double quotation marks in the main text, and ones I quote from others, that is, quotes of quotes, indicated by double, then single quotation marks. The sources for all quotations appear in the endnotes. Taken together, these sources offer a rich picture of the past. As the historian John Lewis Gaddis has written, the direct experience of events isn't necessarily the best path toward understanding them because your field of vision extends no further than your own immediate senses. Participants in events are, by definition, on the ground, in a crowd with many others, amid the pressures of the day. Although I lived through some of the events as a bystander, only after completing my training in the PhD program in history at Yale University did I realize how much I had missed. Historians are the equivalent of onlookers from a great distance. The detail is less, but the perspective is greater. As Gaddis put it, the historian of the past is much better off than the participant in the present from the simple fact of having an expanded horizon. The way personal involvement can become problematic for later historical assessments is apparent in comments by and about the two men who kicked off the fight over NATO expansion, Gorbachev and Baker. The former Soviet leader made headlines in 2014 with passionate remarks on whether Baker had promised him the alliance would never expand. Gorbachev's views matter because, by refraining from the use of force to shore up crumbling Soviet power in 1989, he opened the door to all that followed. That self-restraint justly earned Gorbachev the Nobel Peace Prize, but it also contributed to his fall from power after the Atlantic Alliance started enlarging eastward across the Cold War line. Asked about expansion in 2014, the former Soviet leader became defensive. He told an interviewer that the alliance's enlargement was not his fault because the issue never came up on his watch. The topic of NATO expansion was not discussed at all, and it wasn't brought up in those years. Referring to himself in the third person and assigning blame to his successors, he instructed the interviewer what to write. Don't portray Gorbachev and the then Soviet authorities as naive people who were wrapped around the West's finger. If there was naivete, it was later, when the issue arose. For good measure, he repeated that not a single Eastern European country raised the issue, not even after the Warsaw Pact ceased to exist in 1991, and Western leaders didn't bring it up either. Numerous commentators have uncritically repeated Gorbachev's claims, often verbatim, that NATO expansion arose only after his fall from power, or that, if it did come up on his watch, it did so only with regard to Eastern German territory, not Central and Eastern Europe. Yet the Soviet leader's claims do not accord with his own written records, such as this one from May 1990. I told Baker, we are aware of your favorable attitude toward the intention expressed by a number of representatives of East European countries to withdraw from the Warsaw Pact in order to join NATO later. Records from other world leaders tell a similar story, even before 1990. By November 24, 1989, just 2 weeks after the fall of the wall, President Bush was already thinking strategically about the future of all of Europe. As he told British Prime Minister Thatcher that day, leave out East Germany. What if East European countries want to leave Warsaw Pact? NATO must stay. In other words, if those countries were considering an exit from the pact, their involuntary military alliance with Moscow, then the obvious question, which Bush sensed intuitively, was what they would do after leaving. Thatcher thought that keeping the Warsaw Pact, which she later described as a fig leaf for Gorbachev, made the most sense, but Bush was not convinced. Instead, by February 2nd through 4th, 1990, there were communications between the State Department, its West German counterpart, and the Chancellery, speculating on whether the question of territorial coverage from NATO for Eastern Europe might arise, a development Moscow would obviously oppose. On February 6th, the West German and British foreign ministers discussed whether Gorbachev would specifically insist that Hungary should not become part of the alliance. On February 8th, the day before meeting with Gorbachev, Baker informed Bush that he had discussed NATO with Czechoslovak leaders and that managing the unification of Germany within NATO could be very important for these Central Europeans. From February 20th to 27th, the U.S. Deputy Secretary of State visited Hungary and Poland, among other countries in the region, and discussed with the Hungarian Foreign Minister how a new NATO could provide a political umbrella for Central and Eastern Europe. On March 3rd, the Czechoslovak Foreign Minister visited NATO headquarters in Brussels. On March 12th, Baker's subordinates produced an early assessment of the alliance's potential role in Central and Eastern Europe. By March 17th, Czechoslovakia, Hungary, and Poland were openly criticizing Moscow for its opposition to NATO moving eastward across the Cold War line. On March 21st, the Polish foreign minister also visited alliance headquarters. During the summer and fall, many of his fellow Central and Eastern European leaders either made similar visits themselves or hosted NATO's Secretary General. In 1991, Bush even speculated with Drezner on ways for NATO to create connections to the Baltics. Moreover, these signs of interest in the alliance paralleled similar signs of interest in the European Community, EC, such as Hungary's formal request for membership, submitted on November 16, 1989, just 1 week after the fall of the Berlin Wall. Hungary and other reform-minded Warsaw Pact members also signaled to West Germany in 1989 that the main reason they were not yet trying to exit the pact, as well as join the EC, was tactical. Because they knew the survival of the pact was an existential question for Gorbachev, they did not want to undermine it, or him, too soon. Doing so might lead to his ouster by Soviet reactionaries, who would end the reform process in all of Central and Eastern Europe and reassert Moscow's control over the region. But the end of the pact was nonetheless in sight, and the exploration of future options was underway. In short, contrary to Gorbachev's oft-cited statement, the fight over Central and Eastern Europe's future in Western institutions such as the EC and NATO began with the fall of the wall. Like Gorbachev, Baker was also forced to leave office, and he also put a great deal of subsequent effort into shaping the narrative of what he had done while in power. After Bush's loss in the 1992 election returned the secretary to private life, Baker hired a team of researchers and writers to help him produce his memoirs. One of them was Andrew Carpendale, an admirer of Baker's who had worked with the secretary in the State Department, become his chief speechwriter, and taken part personally in the dramatic events of those years. But when Baker excised or rewrote numerous passages of the book manuscript his team had drafted, particularly concerning the history of the years 1990 to 91, Carpendale felt compelled to assail his boss in writing on January 23, 1995. "I want to register my vehement disagreement with several of the substantive changes you made," he warned Baker. "You alone will have to bear the burden when the lead review in the New York Times Book Review begins something like this. In a colorful and readable memoir, James A. Baker III manages to do as an author what he did so well in over 12 years in power in Washington, glorify his own successes, avoid any hint of failure, and skirt the truth." Carpendale's prediction was accurate. 9 months later, the reviewer for the Times concluded that "the man famous for spinning the message of the week is now spinning his own image for history." As British Prime Minister Winston Churchill once confessed, his personal prescription for ensuring a favorable image in history was to write that history myself, and Gorbachev and Baker appear to have embraced the sentiment. Political actors understandably want to tell their story, but history needs to be more than autobiography, especially when the consequences of their actions are so far-reaching. Seizing instead on all possible sources to take a dispassionate look at the start of NATO's post-Cold War expansion yields a large payoff. We see how both its successes and its failures set up the Atlantic world's time of troubles today, and we gain wisdom on how to prepare for an uncertain future. While this history may be complicated, the narrative setup of this book is simple. It investigates NATO's decade of change in three parts. Each one blends the most relevant historical events into an analytical narrative. Part 1, covering the years 1989 to 92, opens with a wall falling and new democracies rising, to the joy of most of the world, but to the horror of Putin and Soviet leaders who believe their victory in World War II earned them the lasting right to dominate Central and Eastern Europe. Kohl, the West German chancellor at the time, consistently uses one metaphor to advise his fellow Western leaders how to respond. Get their harvest in before the coming storm. He means that the West must rush in 1990 to secure the gains of its Cold War success before hardliners in Moscow mount a resistance to Gorbachev. Acting accordingly, Bush and Kohl pull off both unification and the enlargement of NATO beyond its Cold War border to Eastern Germany in a mere 329 days. Soon thereafter, a battle for power in Moscow indeed breaks out, just as Kohl predicted. But the storm is stronger than even he expected. The attempted coup and its consequences sweep away not just Gorbachev, but the entire Soviet state by the end of 1991, creating opportunities for the Atlantic Alliance to expand farther eastward, but introducing dramatic new risks as the old Soviet nuclear arsenal falls into multiple untested hands. And even as Washington is attempting to master these challenges, U.S. voters send the Bush administration packing in 1992, putting a young Arkansas governor in the geopolitical hot seat. Part 2, 1993 to 94, explores the clearing in U.S. Russian relations after this storm and the potential that it reveals. Despite the upheaval in Moscow, reactionaries do not regain control as Kohl had feared. Instead, remarkably, there's a precious second chance at cooperation. Power falls to another leader willing to implement reforms and cooperate with the West. Yeltsin, who in 1993 swiftly establishes a rapport with Clinton. Boris and Bill, as they become known, develop the closest relationship ever to exist between a Russian and an American leader, with Clinton eventually visiting Moscow more times than any U.S. president before or since. Trying to protect that rapport, but also trying to respond to both Central and Eastern European appeals for NATO membership and Balkan bloodshed, Clinton seizes on the incremental partnership plan for all of Europe, authored largely by his Polish-born chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff, JCS, General John Shalikashvili. But the events of late 1993 and 1994, Yeltsin's tragic use of force against opponents in Moscow and Chechnya, the resurgence of the Republican Party, and skilled maneuvering by insiders in Washington, combined to convince Clinton to abandon the partnership solution. Part 3, 1995 to 99, chronicles Clinton taking a more aggressive stance on NATO expansion as the Boris and Bill relationship disintegrates into alcohol-fueled tirades by Yeltsin and stonewalling by the U.S. president over military action in Kosovo. Meanwhile, Central and Eastern Europeans are justifiably thrilled as the countdown to their NATO membership commences. Western Europeans decide privately that Russia will never join the EU, and a frost settles over U.S.-Russian relations as Clinton suddenly faces the question of whether he will survive in office, thanks to the revelation of his sexual relationship with White House intern Monica Lewinsky, which bursts into the headlines just as Putin is climbing the ladder of power in Russia. With both Moscow and Washington having failed to create lasting cooperation in the thaw after the Cold War, the Russian forces of reaction that Cole had feared back in 1990 win out after all. The conclusion steps back from the narrative and examines how, as described in each of those three parts, the sitting U.S. president makes irreversible decisions about NATO's future and how those decisions interact with Russian choices. In essence, the American leader turns the policymaking equivalent of a ratchet, a tool that allows motion in one direction only, and Russia responds. Each turn forecloses other possibilities, making it impossible to reverse course and choose a different direction. The consequences become cumulative as the sequence of decisions unfolds. First, as part of the larger goal of German unification, Bush forecloses all options for post-Cold War transatlantic security, other than an Atlantic alliance capable of extending Article 5 beyond the Cold War line. Next, Clinton forecloses his own administration's option of incremental partnership as a means of achieving that expansion. Finally, Clinton forecloses options to limit either the location or number of new allies, or the pace at which they are added, or the membership benefits they can enjoy. These presidential ratchet turns matter greatly to the Atlantic alliance. Although NATO contains many countries, each with its own opinions, American military dominance means it is ultimately American views that matter when NATO's Article 5 guarantee is at issue. This was as true in the 1990s as it is today, and these ratchet turns have a lasting impact, not least in the way they constrain subsequent U.S. policymakers, who no longer have a full array of options either for structuring transatlantic security or for dealing with post-Soviet states when their tour of duty commences. Finally, the book looks at the legacy of these events for today. Central and Eastern Europeans become NATO allies, only to discover that alliance membership does not automatically lock in their hard-won democratic gains. Washington wins its struggle with Moscow over NATO in the 1990s, but the way the United States goes about enlargement means it loses options with regard to Russia in the longer term. The big play in Europe would have been to create a dynamic that established lasting cooperation rather than confrontation between Russia and the West. After World War II, America worked with former adversaries to turn them into long-term allies, so there was a precedent for such an achievement. The challenge after the joyous, peaceful ending to the Cold War was to repeat that performance. Instead, leaders in Washington and Moscow snatch stalemate from the jaws of victory. American choices combine with the tragic failures of both Gorbachev and Yeltsin to undercut the potential for post-Cold War cooperation and to push the U.S.-Russian relationship into a period of uneven decline. Although there are notable episodes reprising the spirit of cooperation, such as the expressions of sympathy from Moscow to the United States after the September 11, 2001 attacks, or the signing of a nuclear accord in 2010, the overall trend is downward. It reaches a frightening new low with the 2014 invasion of Ukraine and hits bottom, so far, in the years 2016 to 21, when Putin conducts massive cyber infiltration of U.S. businesses, institutions, and elections. If this history ends with Putin, it also begins with him. In 1989, he is a bit player in divided Germany, watching in horror as the wall opens and the West moves east. In 1999, he becomes Yeltsin's hand-picked heir. In the decade between, he largely disappears, fitting behavior for a member of the secret police, from the international stage as he struggles to find his footing back home. But his grievance at Russia's loss of empire and international standing endures throughout and is widely shared among other displaced servants of the Soviet state. If it is surprising that he eventually reemerges from among them as the country's leader, It is not surprising that someone with his views becomes a serious contender for power once Russian reforms yield economic chaos. And when it becomes clear that it is indeed Putin who has ended up on top, his personal preferences swiftly assume an outsized role. He chooses to vent his grievances by using a repurposed history of the 1990s, citing NATO's decision in those years to deploy military infrastructure at our borders as justification for renewed bloodshed and competition with the West. Given the significance of these events for today's world, it is time to take a serious look, using all available historical evidence, at what unfolded during the 1990s. At the start of that decade, a better future seemed not only possible, but likely. To understand how we got to where we are today, we must judge the new times by the past. Part 1. Harvest and Storm, 1989 to 92. Chapter 1. Two Dresden Nights. Lieutenant Colonel Vladimir Putin decided, on a December night in Dresden in 1989, to do whatever it took to defend Soviet authority, his colleagues, and himself. No one else was coming to do it. The Berlin Wall was open, and the East German regime was collapsing. A crowd of peaceful protesters had just flooded the nearby headquarters of his secret police allies, the Stasi, overwhelming the guards as they had overwhelmed the regime, through conviction and sheer numbers rather than through violence. Now, some 24 protesters were drifting around the corner to the deceptively modest outpost of Soviet state security, or the KGB, on Angelica Street, where on December 5th he was the senior officer on site. Putin worried about more than himself and the handful of men on duty. As he later admitted, "We had documents in our building." Those documents reportedly contained information on front companies holding billions of Deutsche Marks for the KGB and its partners, on espionage against Western high-tech industries to benefit their inept Eastern rivals, and on contacts with the violent Red Army faction, taking advantage of Dresden's backwater status as a place to plan assassinations. Putin also safeguarded his own work against the main opponent, NATO. Seeking armed support, he called a colleague with the Soviet military forces in Dresden. The person who answered the phone, however, refused to grant Putin's request without explicit permission from Moscow, and then added, "Moscow is silent." Putin decided to act on his own. He walked toward the small crowd at the front gate in what a witness later described as a slow and calm manner. For a while, he simply stared. Then, after a brief conversation during which the protesters were surprised to hear his fluent German, he informed them that if they entered, they would be shot. The 24 protesters paused, murmured, and decided to go back to the Stasi headquarters. Putin returned to the house where he and his crew destroyed everything, burning papers night and day, until the furnace burst. According to his own account, the phrase, "Moscow is silent," haunted him for years. "His country should have defended itself," he later remarked, instead of offering silence. "We would have avoided a lot of problems if the Soviets had not made such a hasty exit from Eastern Europe." Putin formed a lasting conviction on the need to avoid what he called a paralysis of power. As he put it in the year he became president of Russia, "Only one thing works in such circumstances, to go on the offensive. You must hit first, and hit so hard that your opponent will not rise to his feet." As the young KGB officer was coming to this realization, the heavyweights who ran their respective countries readied themselves for combat as well. A high-stakes game to fill the vacuum left by retreating Soviet power was beginning. It soon moved from the streets of East Germany to the grandest halls of power. If the venues became more refined, the struggles were no less fierce. The opening of the Berlin Wall had signaled the end of the Cold War order and the beginning of another as yet unknown. Everything, including NATO's future, was on the table. Moscow could demand that Germany pull out of NATO in exchange for Soviet approval of its reunification, a presumably fatal development for an alliance that had been a prominent landmark in the transatlantic world for 40 years. The fight over NATO's creation. The alliance's longevity belied how big the fight had been over whether to create it in the first place. NATO had come into being with the signing of the Washington Treaty on April 4, 1949, in a grand neoclassical ballroom on Constitution Avenue near the White House. President Harry Truman made brief remarks, calling on the new alliance to become a shield against aggression and fear of aggression. Afterward, some of the attendees shared bourbons in the bar of the nearby Willard Hotel, but in London, a British diplomat was not celebrating. Hugh Dalton noted in his diary with bitter satisfaction that it is a final entanglement of U.S. and Canada in Europe. The alliance was the best we can do and, of its kind, very good in this miserable situation. The misery arose from the destroyed hopes of harmony after World War II. Although the conflict had ended, Europe lay in ruins, hunger and disease were everywhere, and tensions with Moscow over the division of post-war authority created fresh threats. President Franklin D. Roosevelt, who had led the United States to a victory he did not live to see, had died hoping to create lasting peace both in Europe and with the Soviet Union. He sought to construct a durable post-war order by offering Moscow a prominent place in it. Knowledge of Roosevelt's strategy for accomplishing this goal had, however, largely disappeared on April 12, 1945, when he died without having taken Vice President Truman into his confidence. Stunned by the swiftness with which he had become the leader of a country in the throes of reshaping world order, Truman urgently grilled Roosevelt's advisors, trying to figure out what his predecessor had intended. With some advisors promoting cooperation action with Moscow and others urging less cooperation, Truman increasingly found himself drawn to the latter group. Its members seized on his inexperience to promote a harder line than Roosevelt likely would have pursued. Increasingly aggressive Soviet moves to crush independence in Central and Eastern Europe reinforced Washington's growing sense that even though one conflict had barely ended, another had begun, the Cold War. As Moscow began drawing what Winston Churchill famously termed an Iron Curtain across Europe, the ostensibly temporary dividing line within occupied Germany became increasingly permanent. A new state also emerged on that front, namely the Federal Republic of Germany, FRG, or West Germany. Rising tension with Moscow also helped persuade a reluctant Congress in 1948 to approve a generous plan of economic aid to Europe, originally proposed by Secretary of State George Marshall in June 1947. British Foreign Minister Ernest Bevin felt, however, that economic assistance was not enough. There needed to be military muscle as well. Bevin had already called for a new Western Union consisting of Britain, France, and the Benelux countries, Belgium, the Netherlands, and Luxembourg, as a first step. It came into being with the Brussels Treaty of March 17, 1948, in the wake of the de facto Soviet takeover of the Czechoslovak government. His larger hope, however, was for a transatlantic organization. The U.S. Congress responded to the Brussels Treaty in a cautiously favorable way with the Vandenberg Resolution, named for its sponsor, Michigan Senator Arthur Vandenberg. He was, in the words of the soon-to-be Secretary of State, Dean Acheson, a hurricane of a man, capable of producing impressively heavy wordfall. Vandenberg also enjoyed a rare capacity for instant indignation, often before he understood an issue or even that there was an issue. This talent proved useful for bulldozing opposition, as Vandenberg and like-minded politicians struggled to bring the skeptical majority around to the idea of U.S. membership in an expanded version of the Brussels Alliance. They convinced the Senate to pass his resolution on June 11, 1948, opening the door to American association with regional and other collective arrangements, though without specific details, and with an understanding that nothing would happen until after that year's election. Soviet miscalculations soon helped advance Bevin and Vandenberg's cause. Moscow began blockading Berlin 2 weeks after the resolution's passage, leading to the Berlin airlift of 1948 to 49. The Soviet blockade was a major strategic blunder. It profoundly shifted the trajectory of the early Cold War by diminishing U.S. opposition to remilitarizing the American commitment to Europe. As the alliance took shape, however, supporters still had to fight off doubters at home and abroad. George Kennan, the U.S. diplomat who had proposed the strategy of containing rather than actively combating Moscow, was aghast. He preferred the economic approach embodied in the Marshall Plan. To be sure, Kennan sympathized with the pleas of devastated European states seeking cover. Washington could hardly tell war-torn countries to stop looking down into the chasm of their own military helplessness as tensions with the Soviet Union rose. But he opposed a permanent alliance because he felt the long-term cost was too high. Such an alliance, he felt, would undermine the ultimate goals of his patient but firm containment policy— to induce, by economic and political means, a change in Moscow's thinking that would eventually enable a negotiated settlement of differences while avoiding the twin dangers of domestic authoritarianism and global war. A standing alliance against Moscow would hinder, not help, the achievement of those goals, especially since NATO would have no obvious stopping point in Europe if it started taking on members beyond those directly on the Atlantic seaboard. In Kennan's view, such an alliance, while understandably desirable in the short run, would ultimately increase tensions and reduce U.S. options for peaceful resolution of any conflict with the Soviet Union. French diplomats had their own concerns. They made clear that they wanted the alliance's membership strictly limited, but the United States insisted on reaching out widely to add both stepping stones across the Atlantic, the Azores, Greenland and Iceland, and Scandinavian countries. While interested in membership, such countries knew they had to avoid provoking their Soviet neighbors and had been considering some kind of Scandinavian defense union among themselves. A compromise resulted. Denmark, Iceland, and Norway became NATO allies after negotiations over such a defense union collapsed, but restricted or refused nuclear warheads, bases, and certain military activities on their territory. In April 1949, the fight over NATO's creation ended in success for its supporters. The Senate voted 82-13 to ratify the Washington Treaty. On paper, the accord's guarantees were impressively strong, with Article 5, the strongest of all, requiring each member to consider an attack on any other state's territory as an attack on its own. A North Atlantic Council, NAC, composed of member states' leaders or their representatives, presided over by a secretary general, came into being as the top policymaking body. But the alliance remained a paper tiger for roughly the first 14 months of its existence. Neither NATO's civilian nor its military components evolved much at first. Armies in Western Europe had demobilized significantly since the war's end, in contrast with 175 Soviet divisions in the East, which, despite the cessation of hostilities, had remained in varying states of readiness. It took three startling developments to make NATO begin serious military preparations. The unexpectedly early detonation of a Soviet nuclear device in August 1949, the success of the communists in China in October 1949, and, most important, the North Korean invasion of South Korea in June 1950. The first two developments signaled rising communist power, and the third set a dangerous precedent. If communists were detonating nuclear weapons, seizing China, and invading South Korea, the logic went, they would certainly try to take West Germany. The resulting panic had far-reaching consequences. In Europe, it helped advocates of multilateral organizations, such as a European Economic Community. In Washington, it meant victory for supporters of a hardline policy document that called for extensive militarization and nuclearization of containment. And in the new transatlantic alliance, the panic helped put the O in NATO. Truman announced on September 9, 1950, that he was sending substantial ground forces back to Europe. Those forces would serve under an integrated NATO command structure, but with a U.S. general, the first Supreme Allied Commander Europe, or SECUR, Dwight D. Eisenhower, at the top. The most prominent remaining opponent of entangling alliances, Ohio Senator Robert Taft, tried to fight these developments but failed. A Senate resolution in April 1951 cleared the legal path. At this point, NATO started taking on structure. It established a military headquarters, known as Supreme Headquarters Allied Powers Europe, or SHAPE. A permanent civilian secretariat emerged to support the first Secretary General, Lord Ismay of Great Britain. The alliance's structures became even more defined at a meeting in Lisbon in February 1952. Among other topics, this conference set the Lisbon goals on burden sharing, setting off decades of debate. The alliance also began expanding, reaching out to Greece and Turkey, which became members in 1952. The big question, however, was what to do about West Germany. With NATO getting serious about preparing for a Soviet invasion, the value of both strengthening and including the western half of that divided country became glaringly apparent. But the sensitivities of the FRG's neighboring states, all seared by memories of the Nazis, made it anything but straightforward to hand guns back to Germans. Here, too, Korea had a decisive impact. The war there made Germany's occupiers and neighbors worry less about past enemies than about future ones. They reluctantly agreed to take West Germany as an ally, but how to do it proved complicated. In October 1950, French Prime Minister René Plevin proposed to the National Assembly a European defense community, calling for the creation of a European army under supranational authority and funded by a common budget. Although the plan had support from both American and European leaders and would have enabled German units to become part of such an army, the National Assembly ultimately rejected the idea. Recalibrating, in 1954, NATO members decided on a different strategy. The Allies allowed West Germany, along with Italy, to accede to the original five-member Brussels Pact and to what was now called the Western European Union, WEU. They also invited the FRG to join NATO, but the occupying powers in West Germany insisted on a Convention on the Presence of Foreign Forces. The main thrust of this October 23, 1954 convention was that the Western powers preserved their right to keep troops stationed in their former occupation zones for an unlimited time. West Germany also had to renounce the production of any ABC, atomic, biological, or chemical, weapons on its territory. Moreover, the divided city of Berlin had to remain in a separate category. There, despite all of the confrontation since 1945, America, Britain, and France still shared occupation authority with the Soviet Union. That shared authority had persisted even after 1949, when Moscow had turned the Soviet occupation zone, which encompassed divided Berlin, into the German Democratic Republic, GDR, or East Germany. Despite the new official name, however, the GDR was thoroughly undemocratic and firmly under Soviet control. These deals brought West Germany into NATO in 1955. In response, Moscow compelled the countries of Central and Eastern Europe that year to join an opposing military alliance known as the Warsaw Pact. The division of Europe came to seem permanent. As year after year of Cold War confrontation passed, divided Europeans, particularly divided Germans, increasingly became enemies to themselves. Fortifications on the borders and plans for combat grew in complexity and lethality. The U.S. Strategic Air Command produced a nuclear target list in the 1950s with 91 designated ground zeros, meaning sites slated for obliteration by atomic weapons in the eastern half of Berlin. It is unclear whether the Strategic Air Command carried out a corollary study of the consequences for West Berlin of nearly 100 atomic fireballs bursting just down the street. Perhaps there was a quiet sense that the command would never hit those targets. or perhaps the consequences seemed regrettable but necessary. The lines of division running through Berlin, Germany, and Europe were now the front lines in the Cold War, and the command had to strategize accordingly. Meanwhile, Eastern European regimes did all they could to prevent their populace from fleeing west, fortifying borders with weapons facing not only outward but also inward. The East German regime produced the most iconic symbol of a government repressing its own people. In 1961, it encased the western part of Berlin in a 100-mile-long concrete wall to stop the huge numbers of its citizens trying to get there, and then onward to the west in search of political freedom and a better life. The division of Germany and Berlin seemed to have become permanent, until 1989, when it suddenly became temporary again. Once Soviet power started crumbling, certain aspects of the way NATO had developed during the earlier decades took on new significance. By then, West Germany hosted so many Western troops and weapons, especially Americans and nuclear ones, that any West German attempt to shed either would seriously undermine not only U.S. military standing in Europe, but the entire alliance. For that reason, Washington had already become worried, earlier in the 1980s, about the massive anti-nuclear protests in West Germany. But the idea that Germany might suddenly unify, announce neutrality, and demand withdrawal of all foreign troops and forces was a problem orders of magnitude more challenging. Abandoning the Warsaw Pact. How did Soviet power in Europe unravel in the course of 1989, raising the specter of German unification and possible neutrality? One of the first critical steps happened not in Germany, but in Hungary, where reformist leaders showed open willingness to cooperate with the West in the teeth of opposition from their more hardline Warsaw Pact allies. Budapest would not, however, have dared to jump ship without several major precursors, most notably the rise to power of a reform-minded Soviet leader, Mikhail Gorbachev, in 1985. Gorbachev, born in 1931, had painful childhood memories not just of World War II, but of his family's suffering in the purges of the Stalinist era. One grandfather was tortured and the other was executed. The new Soviet leader hoped for a better future, partly inspired by the détente of the 1970s and partly by the success of socialist and communist parties in places like Italy. As he wrote in his memoirs, "People deserve a better life. That was always on my mind." His optimism and call for new thinking inspired reformers all across the Warsaw Pact, particularly the long-suppressed Solidarity movement in Poland, which achieved a power-sharing regime in Warsaw. The courage of Polish dissident leaders such as Lech Walesa, who had won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1983, inspired other activists. He had received that award for leading the independent trade union called Solidarity through dark years of repression. Despite frequently being under house arrest or detention, eventually he would rise to the presidency in Poland. In the 1980s, his example inspired other activists, including Hungary. One of them was Viktor Orban, who first came to world attention on June 16, 1989, with a passionate speech in Budapest's Heroes Square. The occasion was memorable. In an undeniably powerful display, hundreds of thousands converged to witness the ceremonial reburial of former Prime Minister Imre Nagy, who decades earlier had been hanged and thrown into a mass grave for supporting the Hungarian revolt against the Soviet invasion of 1956. Orban, the spokesman for a group called the Federation of Young Democrats, capitalized on the emotional reburial to call for the Soviets to remove their still-present forces entirely. Although he was only in his 20s, the speech catapulted him to fame, putting him on a trajectory toward the office of prime minister. The Hungarian who held that office at the time, Miklos Nemeth, had also seized the moment, but behind closed doors. On March 3, 1989, he had informed Gorbachev, "We made a decision to remove completely the electronic and technological protection from the western and southern borders of Hungary." In other words, he was punching a hole in the Iron Curtain. Nemeth's East German counterpart, Erich Honecker, was profoundly worried by Hungary's action. Unless something changed, Honecker was certain Hungary would drift farther into the camp of the bourgeoisie. But Hungary was hardly alone in its desire to burst out of Cold War strictures, as became apparent at the Warsaw Pact's July 7 through 8, 1989 summit in Bucharest. As one of Gorbachev's subordinates noted, the summit had all the characteristics of a burial service. By then, East German citizens had swarmed into Hungary, hoping Nemeth's open-border policy applied to them, too. Technically, it did not, because Hungary had signed an accord obliging it to prevent East German citizens from exiting the Soviet bloc. If Budapest opened its borders in defiance of this agreement, it effectively would be abandoning the pact and changing sides in the Cold War. With every passing day in late summer 1989, both the number of East Germans on the Hungarian border and the pressure on Nemeth to break the agreement increased. He was smart enough to know that if he was going to play his big card, he should get Western help for his country in exchange, but also smart enough to know it would not come from Washington. The new U.S. president, George H.W. Bush, preferred caution to risky geopolitical card playing. Bush viewed that summer's developments with mixed emotions. On the one hand, discord within the enemy alliance was obviously welcome. On the other, he preferred a more restrained response than his predecessor, Ronald Reagan, had shown to Gorbachev's dramatic changes. Although Bush, a successful Texas businessman, had a competitive streak, he had originally been raised in New England, the Andover and Yale-schooled son of a former senator from Connecticut. He chose to draw on this background as the scion of a center-right political family, once becoming a statesman, inclining toward a more cautious approach to foreign policy than Reagan had adopted. Even though he followed a president from the same party, one of Bush's first acts in office had been to institute a review and rethinking a previous national security strategy. He had also asked James Baker, his old friend, former tennis doubles partner at the Houston Country Club, and subsequently Reagan's chief of staff and treasury secretary, to be his secretary of state. Brent Scowcroft, a retired U.S. Air Force general and former advisor to Richard Nixon and Henry Kissinger, was Bush's pick for national security advisor. The two men balanced each other temperamentally, with Baker inclined to push for action and Scowcroft inclined to consider all consequences carefully. But both advisors agreed on the need to keep the group of those in the know small and tight. Truly significant decisions in the Bush era happened, in the words of Scowcroft's deputy, Robert Gates, among Bush, Baker, Scowcroft, and their respective inner circles working in harness together. Bush was particularly solicitous toward Scowcroft, whose wife's extended illness left the national security advisor with a day job in the White House and a night job as caregiver. Unsurprisingly, Baker, Scowcroft, and their teams agreed with Bush that, as the president put it, Poland and Hungary should not expect a blank check from the West, but instead must help themselves. Baker also told his Soviet counterpart, Edward Shevardnadze, on September 21, 1989, that "we do not desire to stir up things up or foment unrest." Instead, Washington would try to assist Poland and Hungary in moving their economies toward more of a free market system. The Bush administration sought a slower pace of change, one that would not trigger reversals. The Soviet foreign minister appreciated the assurance, aware the United States could choose to exploit the situation more aggressively, and replied with what he termed a reasonable proposal. "Let's disband both NATO and the Warsaw Pact. Let's release your allies and ours. While NATO exists, the Warsaw Pact also exists." Baker did not encourage him to continue in this vein, and nothing came of the remark, but it was a warning that serious questions were surfacing about NATO's future. This cautious American attitude, welcome in Moscow, was unwelcome in Budapest, as the Hungarian ambassador to West Germany complained. Prime Minister Nemeth decided to try his luck directly with the Chancellor of West Germany, Helmut Kohl. Like Bush, Cole was the leader of his country's center-right party, namely the Christian Democratic Union, CDU. But unlike Bush, he was the leader of half of a divided nation on the front line of the Cold War, which gave him different priorities. Another difference was that the chancellor had, by 1989, spent 7 years in the top office. Even though critics both outside and inside his own party were gaining ground, this experience gave him the assertiveness to take risks after the dramatic developments of that year unexpectedly created the potential for change. By August 18, 1989, the situation had become so fluid that the West German Foreign Office was even gaming out the consequences of Hungary's quitting the Warsaw Pact. Its departure would exceed Moscow's pain threshold and produce a dramatic reaction that could have unpredictable consequences, even in the seemingly permissive age of Gorbachev. Not only Hungary, but all of Europe, found itself in a precarious position. Nemeth signaled to Kohl that he was willing to jump anyway, if someone in the West would hold out a net. Sensing an opportunity, the chancellor arranged a secret conversation between himself, Nemeth, and his foreign minister, Hans-Dietrich Genscher, for August 25, 1989. Kohl invited the Hungarian not to Bonn, the capital of West Germany, but to Gymnich Castle, a government-owned historic property far away from prying eyes. There, Nemeth complained to the two Germans about the lukewarm support from Washington. As far as he could tell, Bush's highest priority was to avoid hasty developments, not to support revolutionary change. The Hungarian, in contrast, wanted haste and a deal. What he could offer was his country's border and the enormous number of East Germans imprisoned behind it. What he needed was money and support. He described his country's economic crisis and its extensive debt, which one historian later estimated was the highest per capita in Eastern Europe. Nemeth was also willing to give East Germans what they clearly wanted, which was the freedom to go west. They enjoyed automatic citizenship under West German law, so all they needed was someone to let them out, and Nemeth was willing to become that person. Kohl later recalled that upon learning this, he felt tears welling up in his eyes. Reuniting divided Germans had long seemed an impossible dream, but now it was becoming possible. Taking all this in, the chancellor indicated his willingness to help, among other ways, by contacting German bankers. It was the safety net Nemeth needed. On August 31st, he had his foreign minister inform the rulers of East Germany that unless they allowed travel and emigration freedom, which they were not willing to do, Hungary would break its written obligations and open its border to everyone wanting to depart. He delayed implementation of the opening until September 11th and then threw the gates open at midnight without Moscow's approval. That delay was apparently a favor to Kohl. The chancellor was, in the words of British Prime Minister Margaret Thatcher, a politician to his fingertips, and had realized that news of the opening would burst as a welcome bombshell during the mid-September CDU party conference, where he was facing a leadership challenge. By contrast, the Soviet leader was apparently not consulted. As far as French diplomats could tell, Gorbachev had not given the opening a green light. The televised images of joyous, tearful East Germans flooding across the Austro-Hungarian border made the rift in the Warsaw Pact obvious for all to see. The West German Foreign Office estimated that in the 2 months following the opening, nearly 50,000 refugees fled west via Hungary. Kohl's advisors noted privately that they had not reckoned with such a large stream of refugees. The West German Foreign Office later called the dramatic surge a major catalytic factor for all that followed, with political and psychological consequences. Kohl wrote warmly to Nemeth, thanking him for this big-hearted act of humanity that we will never forget. You have, in an overwhelming way, kept your word. The chancellor smoothed the way for Hungary to access a credit line of 500 million DM. He also welcomed Nemeth to his home, a rare honor, to discuss how to respond to breakdowns in the Soviet transport of energy to Hungary. By November 16, 1989, Hungary was so emboldened that it formally requested entry into the European Community, EC, and leaders of Poland and Yugoslavia indicated that they would soon follow suit as well. Delivering the official membership request personally to resounding applause at a meeting in Strasbourg, the Hungarian foreign minister asked that his country's Warsaw Pact membership not be held against it. The reason Hungary did not simply announce it was leaving the pact outright, according to a confidential West German assessment, was that such a rupture might endanger Gorbachev. With matters going so well, Budapest did not want to risk reactionaries toppling the Soviet leader. Hungary's behavior prompted Soviet analysts to begin speculating what would happen if Warsaw Pact states with Soviet troops on their territory demanded those troops leave, or, even worse, if the Baltics demanded to leave the Soviet Union. The West German ambassador in Moscow reported home that the search for a substitute for the Warsaw Pact was already on. One idea was to merge the pact and NATO into a larger pan-European system. Perhaps, as part of that thinking, on December 19, 1989, Shevardnadze paid the first ever visit by a Soviet foreign minister to the NATO Secretary General in Brussels. To his happy surprise, alliance staffers gathered at the building's entrance and, as Shevardnadze walked in, showered him with applause. Hungary thus burst out of the Warsaw Pact even before the Berlin Wall opened. The hole Nemet created in the Iron Curtain was a hole below the pact's waterline. Hardline regimes scrambled to seal off the breach, usually by blocking their citizens' ability to travel to Hungary. But closing off Hungary as a place to which disgruntled Eastern Europeans could flee only led to intensified protests within their own borders, most notably in East Germany. By November, waves of demonstrations were bringing the East German government to its knees, though it clung to the Berlin Wall to the last. Scowcroft had his subordinates carry out GDR contingency planning for outcomes to the chaos. As his subordinate Robert Blackwell wrote on November 7th, "The future of the GDR means the future of divided Germany, which in turn means the future of divided Europe. Nothing save the U.S.-Soviet strategic relationship is more central to our national security." Facing this existential threat, the dictators in East Germany understood that an intact wall was their most valuable property. It not only kept East Germany from bleeding out, but also offered a financial lifeline. They hoped to secure desperately needed financial support from the West in exchange for doling out generous opportunities for tourist and visitor traffic across the wall. In other words, they would sell periodic, limited openings for regular infusions of cash. The GDR's ruling regime planned to retain firm control of such openings, which would remain tightly limited for national security reasons, the same spurious reasons the country's leaders had long used to prevent most East Germans from ever leaving. But in an epic, irreversible display of incompetence, the regime botched its attempt to hint at greater travel opportunities to come. The unlucky Politburo member charged with announcing the proposed new policy on November 9, 1989, made it sound as if the regime had instead declared the wall open. In the heady atmosphere of that tumultuous year, this mistake was the catalytic spark for an explosion that brought down the wall. Thousands, then tens of thousands, then hundreds of thousands massed on the border that night and flooded over it, with or without crossing points. For those crowds, it became a night of jubilation as, one by one, border guards without instructions decided to give way to the massive surge. Once he learned what had happened, Gorbachev sent alarmist messages to Washington, London, Paris, and Bonn, saying he feared a chaotic situation with unpredictable consequences. This panicky message made Scowcroft realize that the wall's opening had shattered Gorbachev's confidence. In the National Security Advisor's view, the Soviet leader had looked benignly, or at least indifferently, at what was happening inside Eastern Europe until the wall fell. Then he got scared. Gorbachev also backed off from the tentative feeler Shevardnadze had extended to Baker about dissolving both military blocs, Now he felt it would be unwise to raise the question of liquidating the Warsaw Pact and NATO. Meanwhile, in London, Soviet diplomats did not even pause to proofread the English translation of Gorbachev's garbled plea before handing it to Thatcher. "I have just conveyed to Chancellor Kohl an oral message, the content of which I consider necessary to disclose to you." Gorbachev had appealed to Chancellor G. Kohl to take necessary and most urgent measures in order to prevent deterioration of the situation with its destabilization. The upshot seemed to be that Gorbachev was demanding consultation among the four powers without delay to put pressure on Kohl not to do anything dramatic. Commenting from Moscow, the British ambassador to the USSR, Sir Roderick Braithwaite, took this anxious plea as a sign that Gorbachev's problem now is to control the forces he has unleashed, adding, "I do not think the Russians know how to regain such control." Like Scowcroft, Braithwaite worried that the Soviet leader's panicked message signaled his effective impotence. Thatcher, meanwhile, had her own worries, namely what she was seeing on television from Bonn. She was, in the words of her staff, frankly horrified by the sight of the Bundestag, the West German parliament, rising to sing Deutschland über alles when the news of the developments on the Berlin Wall came in. She was apparently unaware of, or uninterested in, the fact that the lyrics to the German national anthem had changed since World War II. The Bundestag members had not, contrary to her belief, revived lyrics last used in the Nazi era. In Thatcher's mind, with Hungary abandoning the pact, the wall coming down, and West German singing Deutschland über alles, on television no less, the unthinkable had begun. No NATO and no nukes. To defend their interests, all of the big players realized they needed to discern not just the best opening moves following the fall of the wall, but where to make those moves and with whom. Their choice of forum and of participants in it would decisively affect the outcome. Baker, known as a remorseless competitor and hunter, understood this point better than anyone. As his wife remarked to a journalist, her husband did not waste a lot of time on guilt. In fact, he doesn't waste any time on it. As Baker later said of himself, "I used to like to kill." In his memoirs, he included a detailed list of animals he particularly enjoyed killing: kudu, impala, lechwe, sable antelope, and sitatunga. The secretary knew intuitively that in the coming big game for Germany, getting the first step right was crucial. Any complex negotiation was actually a series of discrete problems, he later wrote, and how one solved the first problem had ramifications far beyond that single issue. His first challenge was blocking the rise of the host of ill-advised fora and securing the right one for Washington. His ideal negotiating situation was one-on-one, but with so many players, that would be hard to pull off. Bush and Baker sought a forum that could quickly constrain debate on the more explosive consequences of the fall of the wall. The longer uncertainty lasted, the more the seemingly permanent fundamentals of European order would come into question. Europe was about to test whether its borders were truly as fixed as a host of Cold War accords attested. West Germany's neighbors were about to learn whether Germans were as happy to subsume their national identity into a European collective as they had long professed to be, or whether they wished to return to their old nationalist path, thereby endangering the EC. And the future of not just the Warsaw Pact, but of NATO was in question. Having lost its main enemy, the alliance would have a harder time justifying its existence. Would NATO need refounding to survive? As they set about determining a forum and a strategy, Bush decided he would not publicly exacerbate Gorbachev's anxieties by posturing on the Berlin Wall. Instead, he would make his move behind closed doors. But behind which doors exactly? Perhaps those to a large hall containing the peace conference for World War II? Decades after the war's end, no such treaty had been negotiated. It had long ago fallen victim to the hostility between the Soviets and their former allies. Scowcroft thought Moscow would almost certainly propose a peace treaty conference in order to slow things down. which would become a major obstacle to progress. By 1945, Nazi Germany had been at war with no fewer than 110 countries. While it was unlikely that all of them would gather in the wake of the events of 1989, the process of negotiating which states to include and which might receive a hearing for demands for reparations would be long and contentious, thus winning Gorbachev time. Foreign Minister Genscher openly opposed a peace conference for an additional reason. Even if West Germans could somehow avoid being cast as latter-day Nazis, they would not sit at a children's table while the big powers decided Germany's fate. Internal communications back at the Foreign Ministry were even blunter. Fearing Germans might come under pressure to participate in a peace treaty conference, legal experts generated a long list of reasons why such a treaty was unnecessary. As one of Genscher's subordinates noted in dismissing the idea, "Even the USA will have to get used to the fact that Yalta is now in the past." The superpowers could no longer dictate Europe's future as they had done at that summit. Bush sought advice, as he often did, from his NATO ally and friend, Prime Minister Brian Mulroney of Canada. Bush was due to meet Gorbachev in Malta in early December.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.